At this time, I'm extremely privileged to introduce our keynote speaker. Sir Ken Robinson is an internationally recognized leader in the development of education, creativity, and innovation. He's also one of the world's leading speakers with a profound impact on audiences everywhere. The videos of his famous 2006 and 2010 talks to the prestigious TED conference have been seen by an estimated 200 million people in over 150 countries. He works with governments in Europe, Asia, and USA, with international agencies, Fortune 500 companies, and some of the world's leading cultural organizations. In 1998, he led a national commission on creativity, education, and the economy for United Kingdom government. All Our Futures, Creativity, Culture, and Education was published to wide acclaim in 1999. He was the central figure in developing a strategy for creative and economic development as part of the peace process in Northern Ireland. Working with the Ministries for Training, Education, Enterprise, and Culture, the resulting blueprint for change, unlocking creativity, was adopted by politicians of all parties and by business, education, and cultural leaders across the province. He was one of four international advisors to the Singapore government for its strategy to become the creative hub of Southeast Asia. For 12 years, he was a professor of education at the University of Warwick in the United Kingdom and is now a professor emeritus. He has received honorary degree from Rhode Island School of Design, Ringling College of Art and Design, the Open University and Central School of Speech and Drama, Birmingham City University, and the Liverpool Institute for Performing Arts. He has been honored with the Athena Award of the Rhode Island School of Design for service to the arts and education, the Peabody Medal for contributions to the arts and culture in the United States, the Gallego Prize for International Achievement in Education, and Benjamin Franklin Medal of Royal Society of Arts for outstanding contributions to cultural relations between the United Kingdom and United States. In 2005, he was named one of the Time, Fortune, CNN's Principal Voices. In 2003, he received a King Knighthood from Queen Elizabeth II for his service to the arts. He speaks to audiences throughout the world on the creative challenges facing businesses and education in the new global economy. His book, The Element, How Finding Your Passion Changes Everything, is a New York Times bestseller and has been translated into 21 languages. His latest book is a 10th anniversary edition of his classic work on creativity and innovation, Out of Our Minds, Learning to be Creative. Sir Ken was born in Liverpool, United Kingdom, as one of seven children. He's married to Therese Lady Robinson. They have two children, James and Kate, and now live in Los Angeles. It's my great honor to introduce Sir Ken Robinson.
I don't know. 8:30?
Is that in my view, there is a worldwide movement shaping up.
And before I worked, because I was in it, you know, I was a child when I worked. And went to school. And I had very mixed feelings about my own schooling. I didn't feel really good school. But I didn't leave school with feeling I knew everything about myself that I would like to have known. I mean, did you come through school thinking, well, I know exactly what I'm doing now, here I go, these are my skills, these are my talents, this is my direction? I didn't. I know most people, I mean, most people I know went through education without really discovering their talents at all. I don't mean everybody felt that, but a lot of people felt that. You know, a large proportion of people felt that. And even worse in some ways, a lot of people came through their education feeling they didn't have any talents at all. You know, nothing special about them. And I've always been perturbed by that, because my starting point is we all have immense natural talents that we're born with. You know, if you're a human being, it comes with a kit. There are tremendous depths of resources, but a lot of people don't, and it's because I think education is constructed in a particular way. And we tend to think of it as just a natural process, you know, that came down from the mountain. But it's really a cultural process that's being shaped by very different forces. And the upshot of it is that it doesn't reach anybody by any means at all. In fact, increasingly, it's not reaching very many people. I moved to America 10 years ago. We moved to Los Angeles.
Celebrating the fact that British had left.
This is not true. I have travelled the length and breadth of the United States, I'd really like to say, and I've worked with groups in every sort of setting, business leaders, educators, librarians, people in all sorts of businesses and industries, in the arts and sciences. I have found no evidences. None. That would indicate that Americans are less adept at getting married than anybody else's. But I think you should know that this is what people say about me, how do you know? When you go to Europe, you meet a meeting, you think, thank God, we're married. We're talking something else. We're told that Americans don't like to be hugged.
Isn't it?
It's a disaster for the country. The country depends upon effectiveness of its education service and its cultural services for its future growth and vitality. It's exactly what you're hearing from the president of the School Lands Association, that education and the library services in the cultural sector generally are on the front line of meeting the challenge that we now face. Now, I say this because too many politicians just don't get it. And I find this very interesting. Well, you know, because you're suffering the cuts of life. And I'm sure you're feeling the blow landing more heavily in some respects on the work you're doing than it may be on other people you know, whose work may be more, but wouldn't be more important. But there's a public perception about these things. When President Obama gave the State of the Union address earlier in the year, he talked about the importance of innovation, and he should. Everyone around the world is talking about innovation just now, and they should be. We'll come on to why, but they should be. But he also talked a lot about education, as indeed he should, as all presidents have. But like all previous presidents, pretty much, all we talked about were the STEM disciplines. Now, don't mistake me, the STEM disciplines are tremendously important. Science, technology, engineering, math. They're very important, of course they are. But they're not all important. You know, I mean, they're necessary, but they're not a sufficient condition for the prosperity of the country. But the tendency to only talk about them, never to mention the arts, or the humanities, or social studies, or physical education, the implicit message is that if you're not good at science or mathematics, or you don't want to be a linguist, or you don't have a real appetite for it, then you're of no great value to the country at the moment. You can sit this one out. You know, we face this huge challenge, we don't have the mathematicians and statisticians and economists figure it out for us. You can sit on the bench, and we'll call you when it's all been dealt with. Well, you see, it's a nonsensical conception, is that in America, the meteoric rise in America over the past 300 years has depended as much upon the great humanists, you know, the great spiritual leaders, the great artists, the great entrepreneurs, as it has on everybody else. A great community, every community, is made up of this rich web of reciprocating talents. And to sing out a small corpus of people and say it's all up to you now is simply ridiculous. And by the way, that's not what the politicians mean, it's just what they say. And the reason they say it is because they go to a default position. They tend to repeat things they take for granted. Now, a lot of my interest in innovation is based on the idea that to meet the challenge of the future, we have to challenge the future and take for granted. And I just want to quickly say why. I say the reason I'm pleased that these various talks are taken on is because it indicates this isn't a niche conversation. It's happening everywhere. I work a lot with education. As I say, I was in it. I work with schools for years. I work with kids a lot. I train teachers. I've done all that stuff. But I work in the cultural sector, and I also work with the business sector a lot because they're interested in innovation. One of the great irons, it seems to me, in the current debate about social policy, is that the strictures that are often applied to cultural organisations are often being applied in what politicians perceive to be the interests of the economy. But if you speak to people in business, they say, well, we want people who are well-founded, who can think creatively, who work in teams, who can be well-informed. That's the big irony. So a lot of what I try to do is to kind of broker a conversation between these different sectors. But there are three big propositions to me. The first one is that we live, I believe, in times of revolution. And I don't say that lightly. There have been revolutionary times in the past. We know that. In the 18th century, it was fairly busy, isn't it? Revolutions. There have been revolutions in China, in Russia. And we're still feeling the effects of it. Now, when President Nixon went to Beijing for the first time, he met with Henry Kissinger. And they were meeting June and I, then Prime Minister and Foreign Minister. And Nixon was briefed by Kissinger that June and I was a great student of European history. So as we were wandering around the garden of the Forbidden City, apparently Nixon was prompted and he said, It's too soon to say.
Socialize with it before. And some of this,
No, this method of cooking fish was introduced into China by the Mongols 900 years ago. So this is like nouvelle cuisine.
Fine.
yes, he said, why is the telephone tied to the wall? He said, are they frightened somebody's going to steal it? A friend of mine has a daughter, she's she can't read or write, but she has her own iPad, and she can log in. And they stayed in the same hotel with us recently, and she came to breakfast, she said to her dad, Dad, the television is broken in the room. Because she'd been trying to stretch the watch. I said, I find this very interesting because it's well, boomer times. This is all magic. But to the kids, it's not. To my father's generation, my grandfather's generation, electricity was a big breakthrough. We didn't think so. Kind of took it for granted. But somebody once said this, that technology is not technology if it happened before you were born. And I think that is true, you just simply take it for granted. But if you look at the curve of technological change over the past, well, certainly the past 150 years, but more especially in the last 60 years, and in particular the last 10, the growth of change has been exponential. I mean, think of it in your field, in libraries. When I was a student, I left college in 1972 and went to London to do my PhD. I started my PhD in the 1970s. I finished it in the 1980s, largely because of what happened in the 1970s. It was a great decade.
Yeah.
Now, yes, now, can I just explain what were they called? Minions. If I can explain to the post-boom people here, because you're probably confused and a bit concerned that all the boomers have just started doing that.
Microsoft Word.
Well, have you noticed? It has opinions, doesn't it? job hunter. If all their work had been composed on Microsoft Word, it would have been the voice of job with all the conditionals, all the complexities that suggest too small ones, and all the passive ones. It had all been this jaunty vernacular, wouldn't it? Drop myself in and okay, it doesn't always work out for me today. I wrote this sentence. I wrote it out for you. I was talking about intelligence testing. And I said this is true. I wrote the sentence, the foundations of the modern intelligence test were laid in the late 19th century by Sir Francis Gottman, a cousin of Charles Darwin, that's true. The foundations of the modern intelligence test were laid in the late 19th century by Sir Francis Gottman, a cousin of Charles Darwin. Microsoft Word didn't like that sentence. Because it has the passive in it, were laid. So little green scribbles suggest active. It's like you can't say this conference was convened, you can say convened. So it didn't like that, didn't like it. So suggest this alternative, this sort of suggested. In the late 19th century, Sir Francis Galton, late cousin of Charles Darwin, yeah.